Hello and welcome to Twist for the third week of April 2013. This week we are talking about the link between epigenetics and anorexia, some cultural significance of space junk, and the power of a mother's touch. Anorexia nervosa is a psychological disease that is primarily embodied in women, but men do suffer from it too. It's an extremely deadly disease, one of the deadliest psychological disorders out there, and it's associated with extreme weight loss and the fear of gaining weight. Now, scientists have always been quite perplexed about the causes of anorexia, whether it is an environmental or a nurture type of disease or a genetic type of disease. And a recent study has shown us that there is a large genetic component to this, possibly up to a 60% genetic component to this, and it is actually the field of epigenetics that is shedding some light on the situation. Now, epigenetics is essentially the interaction of the environment with the genome. In a process termed methylation, the actual genes are changed by the environment that they are in, and certain genes may be turned off, turned on, or the signal may be amplified or quietened down quite a bit. And scientists, by looking at studies of identical and non-identical twins, have actually been able to shed a lot of light on how anorexia nervosa patients have changed in their epigenome with respect to patients that don't have it. This could be extremely promising because, as I said, this is a very deadly psychological disorder, and so any means by which we can have a treatment in place to more effectively treat people that have it, definitely the better. Alice Gorman is an archaeologist at Flinders University in Australia. And she has a really cool job because not only does she look at the cultural significance of relics found here on planet Earth, she is also looking at the cultural significance of relics found in space. She is working very hard to dispel the myth that space is this vast, empty void of stuff. I mean, humans have been traveling to space for several decades, and we are not leaving it clean. Frankly, we are putting all of our, you know, landing sites, probes, explorational tools, and of course satellite debris and all sorts of things. These are all things that become space junk and remain in space. But she's taking this interesting look at the cultural significance of all of these things. There's certainly relics to be had based on what we find in space, and she's most interested in looking at the space program from Australia from the 50s, 60s, and 70s. Now, speaking of space, I wonder what our bad astronomer is up to this week. Hey, Phil, what do you got for us?
Astronomers are gearing up for comet Ison, which may be bright enough to see with the naked eye this fall. Comets are balls of ice and dust all squished together, and when they get near the sun, the ice turns into a gas, releases that dust, and that surrounds the tiny nucleus, the solid part. It forms the head, which can be as big as a planet, and streams off to form the tail, which can be millions of kilometers long. But that happens near the sun when the ice can turn into a gas. Right now, Ison is about 600 million kilometers from the sun, about as far as Jupiter, where it's cold. And so it's surprising that Ison is as active and bright as it is. Hubble was pointed at the comet recently to see how big the solid part was, and it turns out it's surprisingly small, 5 to 6 kilometers across. Usually they're 20 to 30 kilometers across. So again, Ison has surprises. It's tiny and yet very active, despite being so far from the sun. The question is, as it gets closer, how much brighter is it going to get? It's going to skim over the surface of the sun very close, and when it's reflecting that fierce sunlight, it's going to get bright. Now the question is, how bright? And we don't know. Certainly bright enough to see with a telescope, maybe bright enough to see with binoculars, and hopefully bright enough to see with the naked eye. In other words, you could go outside, look up, and see it in the sky. That would be amazing and wonderful. It's not gonna get anywhere near the Earth. We're not in any danger from it, but we can learn a lot from this comet, especially because it's unusual, and that's fantastic. And that's why we're gonna keep our eyes on it, and I think you should too.
You never know what you're gonna learn when that guy comes to town. We're gonna end things off with a feel-good story this week. Scientists in Asia have reported that they have discovered a very highly integrated and complex set of reactions that happen to babies, many mammalian species, including the human one, when they are picked up by their mothers. There's a highly coordinated response of the nervous system, the motor system, and the cardiac system that actually all cause the babies to immediately and very deeply relaxed when they are picked up by mama. And this has been shown across several species, as I said. They tested it on mice, but it's been shown in several cat species and, of course, in the human species as well. Now, further research here on the exact mechanisms that are taking place when these babies are deeply relaxing will actually be really interesting and possibly beneficial to prevent child abuse, to prevent parents who are frustrated from doing the wrong thing, because it's also shown when these babies are relaxed like this, it's a much lesser burden on the mother as well. It's essentially is a win-win situation. The baby's relaxed and they are less heavy to the mother. Feels good. So that's it for Twist this week. Thanks for tuning in. Make sure you spread the word about this awesome new series we're doing, giving you the coolest science headlines every week. Check out the Science Alert Facebook page and like it. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, and we will see you again really soon. Do you deeply relax when I pick you up? Yeah. Can you say hi? Say hi. Look at how relaxed she is. So true.